Or you can also be adopted into a family, right? You know anybody who's been adopted? It's kind of cool because this is where two people, parents, actually choose somebody, and they have to go through a lot of work, they have to go through the court system, and they have to fill a lot of papers, and sometimes they even have to pay money so that they can have this child, and it's theirs. He's theirs, or she's theirs. Do you know who did that? God did that. Now, who did he adopt? Very good. He adopted us. Now, there was a lot of work to do so that he could do that. You know what that was? What did God do so that he could adopt us? Yeah. Not paperwork so much. But it was a contract that he signed, that he died, paid his life so that we could be his children forever. Which is kind of cool. It's even more cool because we don't have to go all the way back to Noah. We're not just related because we have a great, 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 super great grandfather. We have the same father, God. And what does that make us? If we have the same father, what does that make us? Not just family. We are family. You are my sister. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Nice to meet you, sis. You leave me hanging here. I need a high five. Thank you. And brother, 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 brother. Does it get any better than that? You're also my son, but you're my brother. Wow. Now we get to live together here, and one day we'll live forever in heaven. I want us to think about that today, and how awesome that is. Jesus is going to talk a little bit more about that through his apostle Paul today in our sermon. But right now, why don't we fold our hands, and we'll thank God for this. Dear Jesus, we thank you for making us your children, not just allowing us to be born into our families, but adopting us, making us yours, buying us, so that we can be yours and each other's forever. Help us to appreciate how wonderful this is all the days of our life. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, thanks for coming up. You can go sit with your families. We will continue by singing verses 3 and 4 of our hymn. Justice, in order to protect the liberties of ourselves and our prosperity, ordain and set forth this Constitution. And all the laws and ideas that were brought forth were there to promote this brotherhood, this family. America was once called the Great Melting Pot, where people from all over the world, from all different cultures and countries and societies would come together and become one. That was the idea. Over the last few decades, I've heard it said more than once that what was once a great melting pot has become more of a great stew pot. Rather than people blending together, we have pockets of different kinds of people existing in the same space. Is that what it is, though? It goes back to what you understand unity to be. Unity, brotherhood, doesn't necessarily mean the same culture. It doesn't necessarily mean the same language. I mean, there are commonalities here. But unity is an idea. We are united under the idea, under the proposition that all men are created equal. And when that was put to the test, when unity was really challenged, and another president who put forth this idea, 87 years ago, our forefathers brought upon this continent a great nation, conceived in liberty, and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. It's not about culture, it's not about color, it's not about language, it's not about gender, it's about the idea and the proposition that we are all equal. I hope we get there. I do, and it's worth celebrating, and I pray we do celebrate. But there's something much stronger than an idea or a proposition, and that's a truth. As a nation, we're united under that idea, but as God's people, we are united under a truth. And it's the truth that we're going to focus on specifically today, as is taken from our sermon text, Galatians chapter 3, beginning at verse 26. In Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. You belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. This is the truth. You are all one in Christ Jesus. One nation brought out of many, one family adopted by one father. And sometimes that's hard to understand, but it is always worth celebrating. Last 3 weeks have been crazy. I want to apologize if I haven't been here to visit you or to talk to you, because I've been gone a lot. And I don't regret that in retrospect. I fought that in the beginning, and a lot of things, I looked at the calendar this summer, and this was the busiest summer I think I can possibly remember. But my wife, very quick of mouth, sharper of mind, and even bigger of heart, pointed out, no, it's not the busiest summer ever. It is the blessingest summer ever. Grammar aside, it's very true, very true. And I'm going to bombard you with stories from the last 3 weeks. So bear with me because there's a point. And it was very inspirational to me as I look back. The last 4 weeks, 3 weeks, we went to Kentucky to go and preach for a congregation celebrating the 10th anniversary of the church building that God allowed this small congregation to build. Came back and went to district convention where all of the pastors, staff members, staff ministers, teachers, and lay leaders among our people gathered together in the Northern Wisconsin district to discuss the ministry and the challenges and the opportunities before us. And we came back and went to the Lutheran Women's Missionary Society convention rally. And then we finished up with the youth rally down in Bowling Green, Ohio. And some of you said that I looked very bright-eyed and bushy-tailed this morning. Thank you. I assure you all the damage is internal. You ever been on a roller coaster that goes 120 miles an hour in 4 seconds? I did. It's awesome. Takes its beating on your neck, though. But all of these things It really opened my eyes to what I guess I already knew. All of us, as different as we are one in Christ. We are. We're one. A few things, you know, not necessarily in chronological order, but went to the Lutheran Women's Missionary Society, the LWMS convention, and I've heard it said by some at least, that this is a group of silver-haired ladies talking about mission work overseas. That's not true. If it were, that would be great. But it's really not. It's a group of people, some with some beautiful silver, some not yet, but also some men and some children gathered together to look at how God has brought his family together from every nation under the sun. Right before Jesus left, ascended into heaven, he told his disciples, go into all nations, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I've commanded you. And I will be with you always, to the very end of the age. Go and make disciples of all nations. What's a disciple? A disciple is a student, a learner, a follower. But it's more than that. In our sermon text, or not our sermon text, our verse of the day, taken from John, Jesus says, you are no longer my servants, you are my friends. Or in Matthew chapter 12, he looks at his disciples and he says, these are my brothers and sisters. A disciple is more than just a learner, a follower. A disciple of Jesus is family. And God has gone throughout the world and brought family from the farthest reaches of the world. There's some stories that were told at that rally, at that convention, that were awesome, amazing. Neat. I don't know what could you use, but I'm going to give you a couple. There was one. It was given by this family, not in the conventional sense, but a group of people from Hong Kong, who came and some in pretty good English, some in very broken English, explained who they were, who we were. And these are people who had learned the gospel and were sharing the gospel and were partnering with us on sharing the gospel over in that part of the world, and it's a different part of the world, and granted, the people are different in many ways, but what struck me was that, just like us, they struggled with certain things, like bringing up the next generation to embrace and to celebrate and to continue to share what we have, so that it might grow instead of shrink. But it was awesome because there were a group of 8 or 9 people, I'll say younger people up there who were dedicated to this. 5 of them studying to become pastors in Hong Kong. And you realize the struggles that they had, the opportunities they had, just like us, in so many ways. There's another story from, it was an American missionary who helped in Nepal, because the missionaries from Nepal who were there chose not to show their face on camera because, being live streamed nationally, their family, who was still back there, could be arrested and perhaps even killed if they were tied to this. Because that's how awful it was over there. Persecution is terrible. And yet, you know, our children, participating in the kids' care program through the LWMS, have sent money over there to help their children to learn about Jesus. And we provided a ton of great material that we, because of our size and our the gifts that God has given us, have been able to provide. Books and stories of the Bible, truths that God has passed down, we've been able to give to them. And they struggle and they suffer. But you see God's hand in theirs in ways that we don't often recognize in ours. There was one thing that happened, which I'm still trying to wrap my mind around. You know, we talk about marketing, we talk about evangelism, and how do we get God's name, how do we get our name so we can get God's name into the world, into the community. You know, we do mailings, and we do some radio spots, and we do events where we can meet people, and that's all fine and good. They had something that, you know, how do you get your name out there when getting your name out there is going to subject you to arrest and perhaps even death? God had a wonderful plan. There was a televised police operation. They had found out where these Christians in Nepal were meeting. and the police being televised, being cast by the news, so that this might put this to rest once and for all, raided this church, took all of their materials, and arrested a good number of them. Their idea was to destroy this church. But you know what happened? A lot of other closet Christians who were out there saw the amazing materials that this church had, and after the fact came and got some. And more was spread. And I thought, you know, not in any way diminishing the suffering that they have, but do you think that would work in Crivis? We could get Officer Freiwald to organize some kind of a raid, and then get the daughter of Marie and Dick Van Schindel to get her news team up from Green Bay and televise it so that everybody can see how awesome stuff we got. Probably wouldn't have the same impact. But it did there. And these brothers and sisters in Christ cherish that same thing that we do, that they are children of God. One more from that rally. There was another two guys that got up, two pastors who got up from the Apache mission, the Apache church down in Arizona. One of them, you know, related how this all began for them. Back in late 1800s, there was a group of German Lutheran missionaries who could barely speak English coming to an Apache reservation, trying to go from German to English to Apache, going to a place where no one else had ministered to before because no one else wanted to go there, the Apache reservation, because they weren't very welcoming and they were very transient. But they went and God formed this bond, which over the last 100 plus years has grown. One of these young men who was a firefighter in the woods, what do you call it? Fought wildfires. That's what he wanted to do. But God found him. God told him, you're going to do something different. And so he did. He became a pastor, not just to the Apache people, but there was once this mission trip that he went on with a friend over to Italy. And I'll keep this story short. But he met a woman who was out on the street later at night who wanted to talk to them. They said, no thanks, we'll come back. Or they then came back and talked to her. That's the story. But you look at this, what happened as they talked to her and shared the gospel that they had brought from Arizona to Italy. And you step back and you look at this, what do we see? We see, first of all, Jesus coming to the Apostle Paul on the road to Damascus. Paul, who was later on imprisoned in Rome in Italy, his words that we read today, you are all one in Christ Jesus, traveling throughout the ages, throughout the countries, eventually finding its way to Germany, to England, or England, to America. I guess it's England first, right? To America, to the Apache reservation, back to Italy. Who could have planned that route? But God was bringing his people together, wherever they may be. They are one. We. And you know, so often it's they and we, Italians and Apache. It's we. All bonded together under that one glorious truth that we are one family in Christ. It was very inspirational. But, and no disrespect to the LWMS rally, it wasn't quite as inspirational for me as this last week when we went to the youth rally. For a reason that I'll get to in a second. You know, talk about a shift from a bunch of silver-haired old ladies to a bunch of uppity adolescents. I say that in jest because that's often the way it is looked at. But that's not the way it really is. We went to the youth rally down in Bowling Green, Ohio, and there's a lot of cool things that happened, a lot of keynote speakers who spoke about how God is always with us, how God has been with them in the darkest times in our life. There was a lot of worship and a lot of prayer and a lot of fun. We did go out. I was not kidding about the 120-mile-an-hour roller coaster. That happened, and it was awesome. There were these things, but my favorite part, and it just goes to show how brilliant the people are who put these things together, came every evening. About 10:45, and I was reminded that there is actually a 10:45 in the evening. We stayed up, and we all gathered together. as groups for reflection. So all of our churches got together by ourselves, and I could possibly tell you that it was 16 kids and 4 adults, but that really wouldn't be right. It was 20 people. And that became more and more apparent to me, and this is why it was special, because it was close. We went and we shared. You get 20 people to share. That's not an easy thing. But we did. And we were able to share, all of us, fears, weaknesses. And the more we did that, the more I realized how there is no difference. We are all bonded together by our fears, by our weaknesses, by our shortcomings and sins. Some of the fears that we shared, you know, you got past the goofy ones like being afraid of ventriloquist dummies and clowns. Oh, that can be legitimate. You got to the real fears. Fears of failure. Whether it be standing at a plate, waiting for a pitch to come in, standing before a group of people, trying to say the right thing, standing before someone, trying to get the courage to speak. Because of the expectations that are always placed upon us by ourselves, by society, by God. The fear of messing up, of doing something dumb again, something wrong again. We all have that. It's what the Apostle Paul is talking about in that first section that we read in our lesson to Galatia. That we are all, you know, dominated by this law. We are all under the guardianship of this law. Our fears and our insecurities all being brought out. The fact that we continue to fail again and again and again, we are all the same. But we are also